It's a sultry night in July. You've fallen asleep in the armchair. Abruptly, you startle awake, disoriented. The television set is on, but not the sound. You strain to understand what you're seeing. Two ghostly white figures in coveralls and helmets are softly dancing under a pitch-black sky. They make strange little skipping motions, which propel them upward amid barely perceptible clouds of dust. But something's wrong. They take too long to come down. Encumbered as they are, they seem to be flying. A little. You rub your eyes, but the dreamlike tableau persists. Of all the events surrounding Apollo 11's landing on the moon on July 20th, 1969, my most vivid recollection is its unreal quality. Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin shuffled along the gray, dusty lunar surface, the Earth looming large in their sky, while Michael Collins, now the moon's own moon, orbited above them in lonely vigil. Yes, it was an astonishing technological achievement and a triumph for the United States. Yes, the astronauts displayed death-defying courage. Yes, as Armstrong said as he first alighted, this was a historic step for the human species. But if you turned off the byplay between mission control and the Sea of Tranquility and stared into that black-and-white television monitor, you could glimpse that we humans had entered the realm of myth and legend. We knew the moon from our earliest days. It was there when our ancestors descended from the trees into the savannas, when we learned to walk upright, when we first devised stone tools, when we domesticated fire, when we invented agriculture and built cities, and set out to subdue the earth. Folklore and popular songs celebrate a mysterious connection between the moon and love. It's waxing and waning, from crescent to full to crescent to new, was widely understood as a celestial metaphor of death and rebirth. Walking on the moon would have seemed a screwball idea. It made more sense to imagine somehow climbing up into the sky on a ladder or on the back of a giant bird, grabbing the moon and bringing it down to Earth. Nobody ever succeeded, although there were myths aplenty about heroes who had tried. Not until a few centuries ago did the idea of the moon as a place a quarter million miles away gain wide currency. And in that brief flicker of time, we've gone from the earliest steps in understanding the moon's nature to walking and joyriding on its surface. We calculated how objects move in space, liquefied oxygen from the air, invented big rockets, telemetry, reliable electronics, inertial guidance, and much else. And then we sailed out into the sky. In the late Roman Empire, pagan philosophers had attacked Christian doctrine on the ascension to heaven of the body of Christ and on the promised bodily resurrection of the dead. Saint Augustine rejoined in these words, "If human skill can by some contrivance fabricate vessels that float out of metals which sink, how much more credible is it that God, by some hidden mode of operation, should even more certainly effect that these earthly masses be emancipated from the chains that bind them to earth. That humans should one day discover such a mode of operation was beyond imagining. 1,500 years later, we emancipated ourselves. Once upon a time, we soared into the solar system for a few years. Then we hurried back. Why? What happened? What was Apollo really about? The scope and audacity of John Kennedy's May 25th, 1961 message to a joint session of Congress on urgent national needs, it dazzled me. We would use rockets not yet designed and alloys not yet conceived, navigation and docking schemes not yet devised, in order to send a man to an unknown world, a world not yet explored, not even in a preliminary way, not even by robots. And we would bring him safely back, and we would do it before the decade was over. This confident pronouncement was made before any American had even achieved Earth orbit. I actually thought that all this had something centrally to do with science. Suddenly, I understood. Sending people to orbit the Earth, or robots to orbit the Sun, requires rockets. Big, reliable, powerful rockets. Those same rockets can be used for nuclear war. The same technology that transports a man to the moon can carry nuclear warheads halfway around the world. The same technology that puts an astronomer and a telescope in Earth orbit can also put up a laser battle station. A case can be made, then, that Apollo served another purpose: to move the U.S.-Soviet space competition from a military to a civilian arena. Apollo was not mainly about science. It was not even mainly about space. Apollo was about ideological confrontation and nuclear war. But more important than any of this, Apollo provided an aegis, an umbrella, under which brilliantly engineered robot spacecraft were dispatched throughout the solar system, making that preliminary reconnaissance of dozens of worlds. The offspring of Apollo have now reached the planetary frontiers. Apollo conveyed a confidence, energy, and breadth of vision that did capture the imagination of the world. That, too, was part of its purpose. It inspired an optimism about technology, an enthusiasm for the future. The Apollo astronauts on their way to and from the moon photographed their home planet. It was a natural thing to do, but it had consequences that few foresaw. For the first time, the inhabitants of Earth could see their world from above. The whole Earth. The Earth in color. The Earth as an exquisite, spinning, white and blue ball set against the vast darkness of space. Those images helped awaken our slumbering planetary consciousness. They provide incontestable evidence that we all share the same vulnerable planet. They remind us of what's important and what's not. We may have found that perspective just in time, just as our technology threatens the habitability of our world. Whatever the reason we first mustered the Apollo program, however mired it was in Cold War nationalism and the instruments of death, the inescapable recognition of the unity and fragility of the Earth is its clear and luminous dividend, the unexpected, final gift of Apollo. What began in deadly competition has helped us to see that global cooperation is the essential precondition for our survival. Travel is broadening. It's time to hit the road again.